computer architecture floating point, how they are implemented in assembly, and especially in MIPS, like we have used for our lectures until now. Let's take a look. First of all, you remember the representation in IEEE 754 is this kind of things, one sign bit, 8 exponent bits, and 23 fraction bits. Together this forms the significant, and so on, etc., etc. I'm not going to repeat this because I suppose, I assume that you already know this. If not, then go back to one of the earlier presentations. Now, what I want to talk to you about is that the MIPS assembly, it does have an coprocessor that is can do floating point operations. Normally, until now, we've been using these registers. Remember, from there are 32 registers, plus the program counter and high-low register for divisions and multiplications. Remember, from 0 to return address. As you know these ones, you know exactly, I hope, you know how to use all this, so I don't have to repeat all these kind of things. But now we have something new here, which is called the coprocessor. And the coprocessor is floating point coprocessor. You could also have coprocessors for graphics and so on, but this is for floating point calculations. And as you see, it also has 32 registers called F0 until F31. Now, they, as you know, 32-bit registers. Where do I have my picture? 32-bit registers, they can contain a single float. But if you take a double, meaning 64 bits, then it could contain a much higher precision floating point numbers. You know that the number, the fraction, determines your precision, and your exponent determines the range of your numbers. So you have a higher range and you have a higher precision in your calculations. So how does MIPS implement the two? Well, it has 32 registers of single precision, 32 bits, but they can also store 16 doubles, meaning that F0 and F1, they could represent one double, and F2 and F3 would be another double. So it is 16 doubles or 32 floats, and they follow the IEEE 754 standard that we have used until now, that was explained very well, I hope so, in the previous presentations. So we have now to look at what kind of instructions do we have. They come in groups, so let me explain them one by one, and then I will finish with an example of how to use this. So the first group is to have access to main memory. For instance, this one, load word into C1 means F0 T4 means copy 4 bytes contents of address pointed to by T4 into registers. So this is what we call direct addressing, that we take the address that is in register T4 and the address point to the information that we're going to load into the F0 register. So there's just a bit pattern, 4 bytes, 32 bits, will be copied from this address that is stored in T4, and it will go into the coprocessor 1, coprocessor 1, as you see here, coprocessor 1, load word into coprocessor 1. You also have load word into D1, but it's not a word, it's actually 2 words, 8 bytes, so forget about this name, it's load 2 words into D1, into C1, sorry, this must be, I guess, word into D1. Load double into coprocessor 1. Copy 8 byte contents of address pointed to by T4 into registers F0 and F1. So you get 2 registers now filled with bit patterns. So you also have store word, you have store word double. So this should be quite obvious. The other thing is to note is that there is no immediate versions. You cannot do load immediate the value 3 into a register. That is only for integer registers. So only for these registers can you do load immediate. This one does not have a load immediate equivalent. So this one you have to forget. The other thing is that you can also copy around from one register to another, just like in the register, integer registers. You can copy, for instance, from F2 to F0. This you do with move point S. .s, which means copy one register, a single. You can also do with a double, meaning it copies two registers from source to destination. I think this is also quite clear. The other thing is that you should be that moving data between, you can also move between processors. And moving between processors means it just copied the bit pattern. It doesn't convert to things. So if you have an integer one into a register, it doesn't become a float one into the coprocessor. No, it just copies the bit pattern. And then, well, what number that will be up to you. So you have this one, move to coprocessor one, and move from coprocessor one. I think these two are also quite easy to understand. Now this one is data conversion. So if you have one bit pattern in a register and you know it is an integer, for instance, and you want to convert it to a float, you can do to use the word CVT, convert. And then you have to specify the to type. So everything here in capitals, you have to supply some letter for that. And from type also, you have to supply what you want to supply it to convert it from. So for instance, an example here, convert to double from word. Source is, let me see, I think source is F3 if I'm not mistaken, and destination is F0. So in F3 there is an integer word and you want to convert it into a double in F0 and F1 because it's double. So you would do this kind of construction, convert. I hope this is also quite clear. If not, just wind back and listen to again to how I explained it. I will now continue to more advanced things. So branching is also slightly different compared to registers, integer registers. Remember that how we had here branch on equal and branch on not equal, branch on greater than. That was a single instruction. A single step is a branching. Now in the coprocessor you have two. First you have to calculate the condition, and then you can branch on that condition being true or not. So for instance here you can say condition, what kind of condition do you want? So cond, you have to supply something, EQ, GT, LT, LE or GE. I guess you can understand, predict what it means. Equal, greater than, less or equal, and greater or equal. And also here for type, you have to supply either an S or an D, or a D if you want to do single or double. As an example, you have here condition less than double F4, F0. And I'm not completely sure which one is now comparing which one, and once it is true, but you will find this out when you're programming. So I guess, for instance, it will be condition is true if F0 is less than F0 is less than F4, or maybe the other way around. At this moment, I'm not sure which one it is. Now, once the condition is calculated, then you can branch. So for instance, branch on condition in coprocessor 1 is true, then go to address which is stored in T4. Once again, there is no there is only this kind of addressing. It's only T4, it has an address. Branch on condition 1 is true, then jump to the address stored in T4. And don't forget, you have to put a no operation after that to align the next code to an address being a multiple of 4, otherwise the processor cannot fetch the instruction that's coming next. So don't forget that this, because this is a short instruction, then you have to do a no operation instruction afterwards. But I guess you will also find it out when once you're programming. Now the arithmetic, of course, you want to do some calculations. That is the nicest things. So you have the general instruction format is OP, which you have to supply something, which is either add, sub, null, or div. Then you have to say what type, so that is S or D. And then you have to supply the two, like in the integer register calculation, you have to supply the source, destination, and source, target, and destination. So F0 will wind up with the product of your calculation that you have done here. As an example, add double, F0, F2, F4, meaning that the combination of F4 and F5, which is contains a double, will be added to the double that is contained in F2 and F3, and stored finally in the double, as a double in the registers F0 and F1. So So I've put here a small exercise. So let's jump here to the MIPS assembler. We have here, we load a 9 into register T0, so that's an integer 9. Then we copy it, this 9, we copy it to F0 in our coprocessor. Then we convert this 9, which is an integer, convert it from this integer to a symbol and store it in F12. So now that it's in F12, we do a system call, which is 2, which is print float, that is in F12. So at the end, it should print 9.0 as a float. Compiling, running, and you will see here indeed, well, it is run twice because I tested it just before writing this, recording this video. So this is 9.0, as you can see, that indeed a 9 copied, stored first, loaded immediate into the integer registers, then copied to the float registers, then converted into a float, and then printed, and you'll get 9.0. I hope this is all clear. The rest is just some practicing.